That is the reason I started this. It's not my comfort zone at all, but just with all the negativity and the stress that's going on in the world right now, you know, especially as it relates to our government, I just felt like people might need a reminder that we live in a democracy and we really do have the power to make the changes that we want to see. And you do such a phenomenal job of being an example of what that looks like and serving the community, and also doing it in a unique way, you know, with the squad and like not towing the line. You know, there's that partisan talk, and you are not, you know, you create your own, you
it's
do what
still, it's right still really do. Hard. It is.
I know it is hard.
Because sometimes something you're saying is how you feel, but then they're like, oh, that's partisan. And I'm like, I don't know. I'm really saying it as a mom, like we need to do something about this issue. I don't think of it as a democratic issue. I think as an American issue, as a, you know, like parents in America issue. Like we got to do something about it. Yeah.
No, absolutely. And that's what, and I was really just talking, you know, to people who are like anti the two-party system and where there's independence. And I just feel like, yes, if you don't like both parties, that's okay. Do what you feel is right.
I mean, I think the next generation, because my 15-year-old is really just kind of like more independent, and he's like, I don't know about this, mom. Like, it seems like both are falling apart, and he has these values that he believes. So, I mean, you know, you never know what is in store. But I think what I love about listening to my son, who again is 15 and kind of my policy advisor in some ways, I mean, honestly, Carrie, he just puts things in perspective. Like it's like, you know, when are we going to realize like our healthcare system is broken, mom? Like, I don't know how many people has to die. Like, and I look at him, I'm like, you're 15 and I don't want you to be jaded. But you know, he feels like I'd rather be a person that supports that versus trying to put myself in some sort of box or category of being part of something else. And yeah, I mean, he makes sense when he talks about it, but.
No, well, that's what I think is so important, that it's, you know, so much of this is really about your own personal values. You know, you don't have to put yourself in a box to make a difference. You just really have to step out of your comfort zone and make that difference. And so that's with Vote Run Serve, what I'm hoping to do is to introduce people to the different offices people can run for, or that they can encourage their friends or other people that they admire to run for, or just other ways that they can get involved. Whether it's volunteering or serving on a commission or working the polls on election day, which is very important, and we'll talk about on the 16th.
Great need for that right now.
Yeah, so, but to start things off, I'm a mom, you're a mom, and moms have so much on their plates, but we need moms to be in office. I think it's so important, because, you know, if nobody's out there representing those values, who's going to do it for us? And again, you're just like, you're my prime example for all things democracy. So I wanted to talk to you about motherhood and public service and what that journey's been like for you, and what motivated you to start.
Yeah, I mean, I think you know this, Carrie, but some others that might be listening, I mean, I'm the eldest of 14. So I just been, you know, being a child of immigrants, being the eldest of 14, been taking care of people all my life. And I, you know, one of the things I always tell people, it's not my law degree or even my community organizing days really play a huge role in the way I advocate. But I think it's being that mom and the big sister. And really my mom's translator until I was 12, her social worker, her lawyer to this day, and really taking care of my family in ways that, you know, keeps them safe and being able to thrive. And so I feel like that, you know, in so many ways shapes the way I've created the four neighborhood service centers, have done some of the direct services. I mean, what I love is residents will say, I don't know about everything you do, but man, I love the service center. I love the constituent services programs, and your team always follows up. And I'm like, yeah, you know, even my field organizers who came on the campaign side, I told them, you don't even realize I made you all into social workers. They're like, yeah, we noticed them. Like, yep, you're going to help people with their unemployment. How do they get their stimulus payment? You know, whatever issues they're having on their block. But I think, you know, it is, honestly, it's those lived experiences, Carrie, of who we are that we bring with us in everything that we do. And I don't exclude being in public office. I feel like it is very much still part of who I am. I mean, most of us women that I've served with, a lot of us moms in Congress, you know, we did it in a way that I feel like is not, you know, not because we wanted to be first of anything or you know, all the, it really is because of this need to do something, right? Like right now you have this desire to like do something. And I don't know, I think as moms, like, we just want to fix it. Yeah. Like, it's like, we're just motivated. Let's just fix it. You know, I don't care. You know, some might want to use a Band-Aid. Some might want to like stitch it up, whatever it is. But we do walk in these rooms and these spaces, not as Democrats, Republicans, whatever it is. We really do walk in with this lens as a mom. Like, how do we fix this broken system? How do we fix the brokenness that is happening all around the country? And it's really hard because it's so personal for us.
No, I love that. I really hadn't heard it, but it rings so true to me. Like, yes, I'm a mom. Like, let's fix this problem. Let's tackle it. What can we do to make it better? So, you know, you first ran when Yusuf was 3, right? Like, Adam. How did you... Adam was 3?
Yeah, oh, he's in high school now. We just did high school orientation this morning for 2 hours.
Oh,
yeah. Well, okay. I mean, we, you know, we would have physically been there, but because of the pandemic, but yeah, I just, you know, he's excited. I'm a little bit like, my baby is a freshman in high school. But yeah, he wasn't even 3 when I first got elected, but when I got sworn in, he had just turned 3. And yeah, they're so integral part of everything I do. I don't do it as much anymore. And Carrie, you're on part of my, you know, safe Facebook group page for my kids now, because, you know, because of the growing hate, as you know, I don't want to talk about it as much. It gets me really emotional, but, you know, threats come to me, but when my kids are thrown in these letters, these hateful, violent letters, that's when, you know, whatever, but I mean, Adam is a very woke 15-year-old, primarily because he came to protests with me. He came to hearings with me. And Yusuf, his brother, who's 6 years younger than him, he's 9. I had him my second term in the legislature. And I don't know, Carrie, you had interviewed me and I told you I nursed him on the House floor. He came with me all the time. It was so funny because I would just put him on the floor and he'd crawl to the Republican side. And, you know, I didn't care, but I'd be like, oh, honey. But it was great because, you know, some colleagues that would have never talked to me all of a sudden was like, oh, let me hold your child. I was like, great, okay. So in so many ways, he kind of, for so many folks that may have not gotten to know me, got to know me as a mom first. And I just love that. I love that residents and, you know, community groups, everybody knows, you know, that they're part of who I am and why I do things. And they ask me about them. And when Adam comes or Yusuf comes, they like know things and they're like, wow. I'm like, yeah, you don't realize when you take them to work, like they're really listening. And moms know this. I don't care what kind of line of work you're in. Your kids come and you think they're on their games or just kind of chilling or whatever, but they're actually listening and paying attention.
No, time is such a blur. That is crazy, you know, to me. So how did you do it?
How I did is, I mean, I have a big family, but their dad, 100%, like he put everything into it. I mean, he's an amazing co-parent. Their dad and I, might not be together, but we still vacation together with the kids, family pictures together. He's one of my best friends, and we really tag team when it comes to the boys. We do a really great, phenomenal job. I mean, friends of mine keep telling me we should write a book about how we do it. And I think it's because, you know, a lot of, so much decisions and stuff is really centered around them. And even when I decided to run for office, we talked about it as a family. And you know, how I did it. I mean, some days, I'm not gonna lie, it was hard. Some days the overwhelming guilt that you feel in being away doesn't go away. I don't, you know, with this, I mean, I'm not in Lansing. I used to come home every night. It used to drive their dad crazy because I would run to the bedroom and wake him up because I needed a dose of just normalcy and also this realness that comes with our children. And then now with going to DC, it's been hard. My first 6 months was hard. I think it's that physically knowing I'm away, even if I FaceTime, even if I talk to them every single day, help them, you know, with their homework or with whatever it is, it's still being kind of away. And I think every mom, no matter what we do, even if we're working part-time, even if that one day out of the week that we're working outside of the home or whatever, away from our kids, that guilt doesn't go away. So I just remember that feeling would come, and it was so overwhelming and kind of paralyzing. Mm-hmm. And that's when I decided, even Amanda would help me, you know, person helping me coordinate my schedule. It's like, you know, I just don't want anything on Sundays. Like, just give me Sunday where I'm just mom and not trying to save the world.
No, well, that was gonna be my next question is, like, I hate to use the word balance because I feel like there's just no balance in life. Like, sometimes, you know, it's that, but are there things or conversations you have with them or that they have with you to say, like, you know, how you communicate? Because you especially are so in the public, you know, I mean, you are like owned by men, like not owned, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, they're sharing you with a lot of people. And how, you know, how do you make sure you're listening to what their needs are, or how do they come to you with that? Just for other moms who might be thinking about, like, how do I do it? Or how do I have these conversations with my kids to make sure that their needs are still being met while I'm, you know, running on a council, you know, serving on a council or a legislature.
Yeah, or a school board. And I have a friend, Nadia Tanova, who's, you know, mother of three young children, who's now running for Groseal school board. I'm so excited for her. And, you know, this is a person that, you know, I've seen her. She interned when I was working at the nonprofit and then kind of pulled her way up and became a director and now runs her own kind of consulting firm. And now she's running for office and I'm super excited about it. But, you know, one of the things about incorporating them into all of it. So today she had posted her lawn signs are available, and there's the kids carrying the lawn signs, like, all funny and having fun. I mean, if you saw some photos of some of my early days campaigning, Adam, my second term, went with me door to door, and he would, like, press the door. I mean, but so it very much, like, their dad would bring them to me if I missed them, and I said, hey, they even would do a block with me. But even when, you know, different things were happening at work, you know, I sometimes talked about it, like, hey, you know, if I'm kind of down and they're like, mom, what's wrong? And I'll say, you know, one of my bills didn't pass today, or, you know, I was trying to do this or that, and just having a conversation with them about it, because I feel like the more they understand what you're trying to do, the better. I think one time I asked Yusuf when he was really young, because he kind of asked me this weird question, and I said, well, what do you think I do? And then he goes, you go to meetings? And I was like, well, I also do other things, like, you know, I help seniors, I help people that need it, and, like, you know, sometimes people's lights go off, I go help them. And then he goes, oh, okay. When I was running for Congress, he came up to me, it's actually in that documentary, and I forgot all about it, but he goes, Mama, are you going to be president? Because he knew it was something big. And I was like, no, honey, it's Congress. It's like, we make laws and there's like 434 other people. You know, and he's too little. But the best one was when he goes, Mama, who's going to be your boss? Who's your boss? And I said, you know, 700,000 people. He goes, okay. I mean, I just think having that openness, because I didn't have that with my parents. Like, I could, you know how it is. Like, sometimes my parents, like, I knew my dad went to work, but I didn't ask him about his work. I didn't, you know, I always felt like this is something you just didn't talk about. But I think, you know, Carrie, whoever it is, if it's you or whoever is running for office, no matter what, like, really including the kids in what you're doing, not only in the campaign side, but even on in when you win, keeping them involved and active about what you're doing and what you're, you know, I think for them, it's them being understanding that this is so much, like, they're sharing you because you're trying to fix something, you're trying to help people. But it's harder now with the teenage kid, because he's like, can you please, mom, just like,
oh no,
no pictures, no, please, mom, please don't talk to everybody, like, please. And I'm like, now I'm like, oh my God, he just totally wants me to, like, stay back and, like, you know, so it's a lot of that, you know, even today on the orientation goes, please, would you not put any more things on the chat? So I don't know if that's because like, I'm a congresswoman, or is it because like, just, he just doesn't, he's just
he's a teenager now. Yeah. That's so bad. Yeah. Oh, it happens to the best of all. Well, so being a mom, being in the room, how do you think it makes a difference as a legislator? Like, you know, what value do you think and see as your fellow working moms are bringing to the table? Like, why should people do this? If they're like, I don't know, what can I?
Look, the fact that you're hesitating as a mom, as a woman running for office, it's probably, I love that, because you're not kind of like waking up in the morning like men sometimes do. Like, look, you know, look what happened. And saying, I'm going to run for president. I'm going to run, you know, we are so much more thoughtful and so much more like, we actually have this unique, beautiful lens, you know, for all those that are very spiritual and very much like me and higher being, like, I feel like we were born to be these compassionate kind of people that doesn't just see numbers, but says, okay, well, what is this going to happen? What will really actually happen to moms with this? What's going to actually happen to children with this line item or whatever that they're looking at? But I think, and I mean it, when we walk in a room, we're moms first. I don't think there's anything, like, it's literally the first thing that we are when we walk in a room. And I feel like, you know, it's going to keep us making sure that we don't go numb, that we move with that sense of urgency that I think so many of our community members, people that believe in us, that vote for us, want. They don't think is enough, you know, there's enough of that. I just say, bring that all in. And, you know, I remember like being in a room saying, you know, as a mom, and I got men like rolling their eyes. And I thought to myself, y'all had moms raising you and you now you don't want the perspective of, and I say that because, you know, I think there's this undervalue of having, you know, young mothers and folks in office. I see Katie Porter. I see, you know, these amazing other women, like literally I see Grace Meng, all these women that, you know, bring their children to the floor. And I remember bringing Adam, you know, it's with me, but then he went to a meeting with me and Chairwoman Maxine Waters, who, you know, I don't think he realizes is like this extremely legendary, wonderful, amazing woman. So there's Auntie Maxine right there leading a meeting with two other of my colleagues on an amendment that I was trying to push for to stop fossil fuel investment. And, you know, I told Adam, do you want to stay here or do you want to come with me? He goes, no, Mom, I'll come with you. So Adam's just sitting back with his phone and we're at a main conference table. He's behind me. And as we're negotiating around this amendment, Adam comes, you know, so-called whispering, everybody heard him. He's like, Mom, do you have a piece of paper and a pen? And I was like, yeah, Mom. And I'm thinking he's going to sketch. He likes to sketch sometimes. And so I ripped this envelope. I still have it. I ripped this envelope. I give it to him, a little pen. And shortly after that, he hands me this note. That was literally like a paragraph long. Mom, you got to tell them by 2030, that's all we got, that they need to understand. Like, it was this whole explanation, like, tell them. Lucky that he didn't interrupt and tell them himself. But after that meeting was done, it was a tough meeting, Carrie. And after that meeting was done, there was no shout or anything, but I could feel that they weren't moved yet. And so after that meeting, she kind of ended, you know, Auntie Maxine Waters ends the meeting. And I said, Chairwoman, thank you so much, at least for listening and for bringing the folks that have the issue, you know, my Democratic colleagues that had the issue with the amendment. And I said, I know you all heard my son ask me for a piece of paper. I just want you all to know, like, this is what he wrote. And I turned it around and I showed them. And you could see this kind of moment, like this, not an aha, but it was like, you know, moment. And I felt like, because at that time he was 14, my 14-year-old son was in the room, and sometimes there was, at that moment, there was just all of a sudden clarity for my colleagues and Chairwoman Waters. And at that, I just thought, man, we need to bring kids into the room.
I totally get, like, kids do change the dynamic in the room in many ways, and I feel like more of us, as we're working from home and Zooming and different meetings, we're all sensing that and feeling that kind of, you know, they're really what matter the most, and that these issues impact them so much on so many different levels that it, you know, from whatever tension or just anxiety or frustrations you're feeling, that they are like that piece that.
Yeah, because they're coming with such purity, you know, yeah. They really are, you know, trying to fix it.
Well, and so what are the lessons that you've learned that you want to pass on to kind of that next group of moms that are going to join you?
No, there's a lesson that, you know, it was told to me by a judge when I was trying to run. I wanted to run in 2008. It took 7 different people to get me to say yes to run for state representative in 2008. And it, you know, I one of the main things I put on the con, you know, there's the pros and the cons. I put things like, my name is hard to pronounce. I know it's awful, but I did carry. And then I put, you know, even my faith, you know, I knew it was an issue. You know, I put so much weight on those kind of things. And I also put down, I'm a mother of a young son. Like, I'm a new mom. You know, he wasn't, again, 3 years old yet. And so my mentor, Steve Tabachman, said, listen, call somebody that ran for office with young children. And I thought of Judge Charlene Elder, who at that time, I think she had 4 kids, all young age. And I called her and I said, how do you do it? You know, same thing with you, Carrie, you're asking me. And she goes, you know, Rashida, everything at the end always works out. It's like everything lands where it needs to land. And it just all falls into place. And, you know, I didn't really fully understand that. I was like, okay, this is not helpful. And then you experience it and you go through it, and it doesn't make any sense until you go through it. And you're like, oh my God, yes. I had a child my second term. I brought him to work. I nursed him. I nursed him for almost 1.5 years. Like, I didn't stop. I know. But I mean, I thought to myself, well, I'm gonna, you know, at the same time, you know, the other advice is being kind to ourselves. We're not gonna be perfect. So even if I'm not in public office or whatever other position or whatever we're trying to do, you know, we sometimes will say, oh, it's because I work too much, or because I shouldn't have done that. But at the same time, at that moment, I think we're so critical of ourselves that we have to be this perfect mom, perfect this, perfect congresswoman, perfect. I think it's like, no, be kind to yourself, because your heart's in the right place and you mean well. And at the end, again, if it doesn't, you know, it lands where it lands, and to live with that and just be kind to yourself about it. And know this, we are inspiring our children when we do this. I cried on when I got sworn in, and my 2 baby boy, you know, these, my babies, they're always my babies. The way they were looking, and they're on the house floor with their mom, and they're, you know, I get to call out, my vote for House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, and all of a sudden they dab on the house floor. And it was this amazing, just beautiful moment. And I read about all these incredible men, and every time you read about them, you always find a very, very strong mom, a mom that was just like really out there. I mean, you hear people talk about those. And I just want moms to know, like, we inspire our kids when we go and take these risks and courage, you know, to run for office, to be out there, to lead movements. To push for policies that change the world. Our kids are listening, they're watching us, and they're being inspired and very, you know, to me, like laying the seeds, you know, how they say, those are our seeds, and they're listening, and we're watering the seeds, Carrie, by everything that we do, and they're watching. And I that inspires me, and it keeps me going.
Well, I love it. I love you, as you know. I'm so happy to see you. I miss you so much. And to anyone out there watching, I hope that you have also been inspired by Rashida, just as I have. You know, I was so excited. I will tell you this. I sent her an email, and she said yes in 3 minutes. Like, and I felt so bad asking her. I was like, am I really going to do this? Am I going to bug her during a primary run about something I'm just jumping into? And she said yes in 3 minutes. So I didn't even have time to stress and stay up late and worry, nothing. And that's because she's an amazing person. She's an amazing public servant and an example of what our democracy and our government is capable of if we work for it. And we do have to work for it. We have to put ourselves out there. We have to support candidates who genuinely care and work hard. And the media and the memes on Facebook are going to tell you a lot of different things. And that's just not true. Like, you can see this here in this conversation, and I hope you are, and I hope you're inspired, and I hope you heard how Rashida said 7 people had to tell her to run the first time, and I hope you will look out at your friends and family, or even people, you know, you see at the store regularly, or whatever it is who you interact with and engage with, who you really admire and respect, and tell them that, because most of the time we don't feel that about ourselves, and we don't even consider that we are good enough or ready enough or qualified to do big things. But we are. We're all, if we're citizens, we're qualified and we can do this, and we need to do this because we have term limits in Michigan, so it's especially important. So tell somebody you know who you think should run that they should do it, and keep nudging them about it because they need it. And join us in 2 weeks on September 16th, Wednesday at 8 p.m. to talk about voting in November, on November 3rd, and how you could be a poll worker or get involved with absentee ballots. We'll be talking to Nancy Wang from Voters Not Politicians about how your vote matters and how it gets counted. So I hope you'll join us. Thank you so much, Rashida. I don't want to keep you anymore.
Thank you, Carrie. No, I hope you run one day. I've been waiting.
I'm running for city council next year.
Oh, nice. I'm so happy. You have to knock doors. We're starting a campaign school. My campaign and I, my team and I.
Oh, good. I need it.
We're going to start a campaign school. And I mean, we really want to teach people what we've learned and all the 5, you know, races that we ran. And these are community advocates that ran. Like, we never ran campaign. We never ran a congressional race before. Like, we didn't know what we were doing. But we still won. And we're going to teach people. We want to teach people what we know. And we would love for you to be part of it.
Oh, I'm signed up. I will follow up with you about how to get involved.
That would be wonderful.
So awesome. I love you. And have a great night.
You too.
Bye. Thank you guys for joining.